fires one of them. Another one. Alright, looks like the gang is all here. Let's pick off the weakling first. Boom. Should have opened with pillar there, probably. He is not running. Yeah, that was stupid. You should have ran. Give your boys time to collapse on me. Here they come. Make sure we stretch him out a little bit. Nice open on him. This is the tanky one. It's going to be tough, but he's going to be in my face. There they all are. That's the 1v3 situation. Let's get out of dodge. I should have no grab balls for a second here. Oh, this guy's not healing. Good thing. Looks like they don't have a life staff. Get wrecked. Oh my god, there's another one down. 1v2. Okay, I'm gonna stretch him out a little bit, see if he can get him to chase me. I can just save these potions. Shouldn't even need the potions, really. Food. Come here, boy. Boom. Oh my god. Get wrecked, kid. Alright, well, this guy's coming in. He's not afraid. I just killed all three of you boys. Let's go. Big damage. Big damage. Oh, don't fail me now, network. Come on. Oh, no. Oh, that is unfortunate. Oh, I think we're okay here. Please. Please. Woo! Let's go. Let's go.
What is happening, you guys? It's your boy Fry coming at you with some New World PvP, and today I am finally ready to unveil my Firestaff Rapier Glass-Cannon build. I've spent so much time tweaking this, trying different setups, and I finally perfected it to the point where I'm ready to put a video out because I'm confident I'm not going to be changing anything moving forward unless there's a major patch that changes some stuff. So I'm very excited to bring this to you. Without further ado, let's jump right in on how to set it up and how to get the most out of it. All right, so the first thing I want to look at is going to be attributes. The attribute priority is going to be as follows. The first one is going to be constitution, and you're going to want to raise this up to 50 constitution. I have a little bit too much because I just picked up these legendary earrings that have 20 con on them, so I can't actually get below 65 right now with the gear that I have. But you're normally going to want to stop at 50, do as I say, not as I do, and you're going to want to start stacking points into intelligence. And once you get past 300 intelligence, you're going to hit a point where you're going to be able to squeeze 50 points into dexterity without dipping below 300 intelligence. So keep stacking intelligence until you get up to the point where you can go 50, 300, 50. 50 con, 300 intelligence, 50 dexterity is what you're aiming for. And any of the rest of your attribute points, you're going to want to stack on top of your intelligence to just crank that damage out. This is a fully glass cannon build. We are going to be running the light armor setup. We are going to get that extra 20% bonus damage, which is huge. And the light quick dodge roll from light armor is what we're really going to need. And combined with the rapier, you're just going to have a lot of mobility. And this build is really slippery, and it's really tough for melees to lock you down. And you can really kind of outrun anybody in a straight line, which allows you to escape, create gaps, and close gaps and chase people down, like, amazingly. So, really amazing build. Let's jump into the weapon mastery next. So, jumping first into the fire staff. Actually, before I do, let's talk about the important buffs you're hitting. Dexterity, obviously, plus 5% crit chance is huge. 200 intelligence, you're getting plus 10 mana after every dodge. That's going to be vital for this build. And 30% duration to damage over time isn't that huge, but this one plus 30% damage on first hit to full health targets does synergize amazingly well with this build. So let's jump into the fire staff first. And the reason that 300% or 300 intelligence buff is so good because it stacks with this first strike. So if you do manage to open with pillar of fire on a full health target, you're getting the 30% from the 300 intelligence, and you're getting 40% from this first strike upgrade. Those are going to stack. Not to mention, if it happens to be a pillar of fire that procs your rune of Helios, I know you're not usually going to be standing in rune of Helios, but if it procs your rune of Helios with that pillar, it's also going to benefit from the 30% of the rune of Helios. So this is actually huge. And in open world, a lot of times you're not going to find the situation just catching someone like logging a tree or mining that's standing still, and you can just open with pillar from a distance. But what does happen in like 1v2s, 1v3s, 1vxs, you're attacking like a ranged user, and then a melee comes in and tries to help gank you, and they're at full health because you haven't touched them. Then you're dropping the pillar of fire at your feet, and then when they commit to a swing, you drop the pillar and then you roll away, and they swing, miss, they're locked in their swing animation, and the pillar explodes in their face for a massive opening shot onto that full health melee target. If you roll and then combine that with a fireball, it is just massive damage. You're chunking them more, usually more than half of their health bar down, depending on how much armor they have. So this is absolutely huge. We are not upgrading fireball at all. So I tried this so many different ways. So like the scorched earth is all right. Having an extra 3 seconds on the AoE on the ground is okay. You get definitely some value out of this in wars or massive Zerg fights. When there's a huge clump of people and there's so much going on, they're not going to realize that they're standing in it. But in most situations, nobody's standing in this for even the full 6 seconds that it's on the ground. Never mind an extra 3 seconds beyond that. So it's not a huge amount of value. And then catch, it turns out, is actually terrible, because direct hits with fireball giving you 10% of your max mana. I used to think this was going to be huge, but you want to always be shooting fireball at the ground. Like, I shoot it in between, I get that initial direct hit damage on both of these targets. You want to be shooting it at their feet, and when you do hit the ground with it, it does not proc catch. It looks like a direct hit, but you're not getting 10% of your mana back, and you're not reducing your cooldowns by 7%. In order to get this, you're going to have to start aiming your fireball at the actual person, which does the same exact amount of damage as shooting it at the ground, and it's just very much not worth it, because if they happen to dodge through it, now you're hitting the ground at a useless position. And what I found, when you shoot it at their feet, even if they dodge and it doesn't hit them directly, if they don't time the dodge properly, the explosion from it hitting the ground will oftentimes still catch them. So you're definitely going to always want to be aiming that at the ground, which makes this a useless ability and allows us to not bother putting the point into scorched earth. And it's going to allow us to get all of the passives on the fire mage tree. And you don't need arson's advantage, because you have enough mana regen between spell focus and flare. If you're ever having mana troubles, you can just start mixing in heavy attacks, especially in those big Zerg fights. Combined with the 200 intelligence buff of every dodge roll giving you 10 mana back, you should also be running an opal in your fire staff. So when you're doing your burst, you want to be keeping your stamina from capping to get that extra 15% damage. And you're going to be refilling your mana bar all the time. So between dropping pillar of fire and dropping fireballs, you're never really going to be able to, like, I'm fully capped on mana. Like spamming these on cooldown and rolling in between, I can't even get the mana to dip below 50%. So you're constantly capped on mana. You're constantly getting the 10% in power from clear mind. And you know, for those big Zerg fights where you would think you would get the benefit from arson's advantage hitting a large group of people with this, you're standing in the back spamming just these two abilities. You're not really diving in and burning out as a glass cannon. So And in the situations where you're doing less heavy attacks, and you're like in a duel in your open world, you're doing a lot more burnouts, and then you're mixing in a lot more light attacks, which are going to consume your mana and not restore any of it back, but they put more damage down and they apply more burn damage. Then occasionally you may just have to mix in a mana pot, you know, and it's not a huge deal. It takes one global cooldown and you're going to cap your mana back out again. So really, with the passives in the fire staff, the fire mage tree, you're gonna have plenty of mana rejuvenation, and this is gonna also allow you to get these three burn passives. You're gonna get singe and watch it burn, so criticals and every light attack are going to proc a small burn, and kindle is gonna make all of your burns, including the burnout burn, last a little bit longer. So another cool thing about this is, you'll notice when I crit him there, this creates both of the burns. It gives him a watch it burn, which every light attack does, and it creates a singe burn from the critical. So it double dips with the light attack. So definitely this is the perfect way to set up your fire staff. With this build, there's really no other way to do it. This is perfected, it's tweaked. I was trying to run combat speed for a little bit, but honestly, when you are moving in a straight line for speed, most of your speed isn't coming from just running. Like, you mix a burnout in, yeah, you're gonna get that extra haste for 5 seconds, but then during that 5 seconds, you're gonna be rolling and evading and rolling and sometimes throwing another fletch out there. So you're really not getting that much benefit out of combat speed. So not that it's a terrible talent, it's just suboptimal. This is the build that's definitely tweaked to perfection. So let's jump into the rapier next. Real quickly, before we go over to the rapier, I want to talk about the Pillar of Fire bug. I think it's a bug. I'm really not sure. So first bug, we'll go over, I guess, that one that I just brought. When your weapon is sheathed and you press Pillar of Fire, instead of it pulling up the aim reticle, it just casts it at your feet, right? And occasionally this actually happens even when your weapon is unsheathed. I don't know what's causing it, but sometimes your pillar would just drop at your feet instantaneously without letting you aim it. So that's the first bug, and that's a bad one. We're definitely hoping they patch that one out. Now, the second one, where I assume is a bug, I'm not 100% sure, but there's a lot of misconception around it. A lot of people think that if you hit someone on the edge of the ring with the pillar, that you become more likely, or it is more likely to somehow trigger and hit twice. That's not the case. How it seems to work is, inside of this reticle, this circle of pillar of fire, there is at least 4 mini hitboxes, and you can hit these training dummies all day long, thousands and thousands of times. It's never going to hit them more than once because they are not moving. The only time this hits more than once is when a target is moving inside of this ring and they're triggering more than one of the hitboxes. I've actually seen this trigger up, I've seen someone trigger up to 4 hitboxes. I hit someone yesterday for over 8,000 damage in one pillar of fire because it hit them 4 times and each pillar crit them for over 2,000 damage and it almost one shot them. Luckily they had over 8,000 health. And they still had a sliver, but we finished them off pretty quickly after that. So yeah, it only actually happens, I assume it's a bug, against players who are moving. Maybe it's as intended, they want it to be multiple hitboxes, and someone who's catching more of the pillar of fire explosion is taking more damage, I guess. Could make sense, it might not be a bug. It would be awesome. Either way, if it is a bug and they do patch it out, I'm definitely going to be still sticking with pillar of fire. Just that one hit is definitely enough. And the way that this build is set up, it's a no-brainer to run pillar with this build. So yeah, that's enough about pillar. Look at how much that crits for, and I don't even have the 300, the extra 30% damage buff on that. That's just, it hits so hard as an opener. Anyway, let's jump into the rapier. All right, looking over at the rapier side of things, we are fully decked out in grace as far as abilities. Riposte is just such an amazing defensive cooldown. With this glass cannon build, throwing Riposte in at the right time, you really are able to avoid those situations that are going to get you killed. And on the occasion that you do get stuck in, like, say, a gravity well or an ice wall, and you have your Riposte and you've saved it for this situation, you're going to be able to just mitigate all that incoming damage. Even if you don't land the stun, even if you've got like 3 people on you and you're stuck in a gravity well, you throw the Riposte out, they trigger the elbow swing, you are briefly invulnerable to all damage and all further CCs, which is hopefully going to let you survive till the gravity well or the ice wall debuff ends. I know if you get stuck in an ice wall and they hit you with another heavy attack, it freezes you for another second and you can just be instantly dead. So Riposte definitely saves your life in a lot of situations. So definitely going with Riposte, and then Evade and Fletch combined with this plus 20 stam gives you the mobility that you need. The evade with the plus 20 stam and the light roll lets you do a double roll without bottoming out your stamina. You never want to bottom out your stamina because it comes back slower, and it also, you run slower until you get your stamina all the way back. So a big no-no there. And the Fletch, obviously, just great speed, straight line speed, and you can also use it to get that killing blow on somebody who's just out of range, right? Finish is a great finisher move. As far as the passives are concerned, it's a little bit different than a lot of other builds because we're not, with this setup or a glass cannon, we're generally not going to want to be sitting in melee range just bursting damage with the rapier for too long. I definitely do it sometimes against some builds. It's a lot easier, like, against some melees who do manage to close the gap on you and get in your face. You're going to have a better time with the, you're going to want the rapier in your hand in case you get stuck in a situation where you need the riposte, right? But preferably you don't, you want to try and save the riposte, and you're going to have with the iframes of evade and dodge rolling is just going to be a lot easier to outplay them. And when I am in those situations, I'm not really worried about reducing cooldowns. The plus 3 stam on hit definitely seems nice, but I'm really going for this extra burst damage with light edge. This passive is completely useless, but you need it just to get down to light edge to get that extra 8% damage on your 2 middle light attacks and your light attack chain. So when I am bursting with the rapier, I want it to do max damage. That having been said, most of the damage from this build is going to come from the fire staff in 9 out of 10 situations. So this is the build. Feel free to take a look. Another thing that's huge about having Riposte fully upgraded I'll just go over the follow-up with Riposte. You get that 2-second stun when it does land. You have two options. The first one most people know about is you roll. If you're going fully offensive and it's just a one-on-one and you're not getting hit by a bunch of other people, you can roll behind them and charge up a heavy attack into their back to get a backstab crit. A lot of times by the time you get this, unfortunately, the momentum buff seems to fall off depending on how well you time the Riposte. But the point being, you're getting a big backstab crit on a heavy attack, so it's maximum punish, and as soon as they take damage, they wake up from the Riposte stun. So it's one way to do it. The better way to do it, the way I like to do it, is actually immediately, instead of immediately rolling behind them, you want to immediately switch to your fire staff and drop a pillar of fire on their feet, and then you can roll away while it's still casting. And then when the fire blows up right before they're about to wake up from the Riposte stun, they get hit by a massive damage hit, and you create a little bit of a gap. So you can pump in like a fireball, maybe you pump in a fireball, take that split second, roll again, and then you got an even bigger gap and your stamina is recharging, and you can pump a couple free hits into them while they have to now close that gap. So preferably like to follow this up with a pillar of fire, but no matter which route you choose, the timing is really tight. So you're going to, when you do land a Riposte stun, you're going to want to react immediately and either roll behind them right away, which is most people's reflex, or switch to fire staff right away and drop that pillar immediately. So that is the Rapier setup. Now let me dive into some tips and tricks and show you how to get the most out of this build. All right, so the first mechanic that you're going to want to practice and master is going to be your speed in a straight line. So first off, let's just go over rolling and mechanics. You never, like in stamina in general, you never want to bottom it out, because while this is recovering, it recovers slower from zero, and you also run slower while it's recovering from zero. Not to mention, in PvP, if you ever get stuck without the ability to roll, where the roll might save your life, you might just be dead. Like in a lot of duels against like a spear, and I bottom my stamina out and they just get a free chance to CC me, a lot of times this is instant death. So you want to be very careful to not bottom your stamina out. That having been said, you can still double roll with this build by mixing the evade. First of all, let's talk about animation canceling rolls. You should already have this down, but in case you don't, at the end of a roll, you see how he like stops for a second before he keeps running. He stops and then he goes roll, stop, and then he moves. You want to fix that by animation canceling, and the best way to do this with the Rapier build is sheathing and unsheathing your weapon. You can do it by switching to your fire staff, but you'll see later there's sometimes where that causes some issues. So sheathe, unsheathe your weapon is going to have you just keep running the whole time. You're never going to get that stop animation. The other thing that you can animation cancel with is your evade, and your evade is going to instantly give you 20 stamina back. Now there's definitely a stop animation at the end of the evade, but then you're going to go straight into another roll. Because you gain that 20 stam, now you get to double roll with the evade trick. So you're gonna roll, evade, roll, and then sheathe, unsheathe your weapon again. Animation canceled the last one with the sheathe, unsheathe, always. Now, so this is your basic roll using the evade trick. And this is the reason we don't want to switch to fire staff every time, because when you're doing the evade trick, if you switch to fire staff as your animation cancel, for a split second the server thinks you're bottoming out your stam, and for some reason you get stuck in place when you're switching to fire staff. It looks like this. See how slow he goes for that split second? You want to avoid that by always canceling by sheathing, unsheathing your weapon. And then the other option you have is to animation cancel with a fletch. In the fletch, you come out of, hey, you hit the ground running. So you can do a double roll straight into a fletch, and you're going to be max speed. You don't have to animation cancel the fletch by sheathing your weapon. So that's a nice little trick, I will say. Definitely your best burst speed. If you're ever stuck and surrounded by people and you're trying to escape and you have these cooldowns all up, roll, evade, roll into a fletch is your quickest burst. My internet's lagging here, sorry, but that's your quickest burst of speed to get out of dodge. And then if you have a distance, you're going to be able to start mixing in the burnout. The problem with the burnout is for a split second he stops. So I'll just show you what I normally do. If I've got enough distance to do this, it's gonna look like roll, evade, roll, sheath, switch to fire staff, and then burnout. And while he's casting that, he switches to he stops for a split second. So you want to make sure you're not doing this in a situation where that's gonna get you hit by like an axe or a hammer or something huge, or maybe even a stun, right? Definitely don't do that when you're anywhere near a spear, right? So but if you do have the distance or you're trying to chase somebody down, that is your fastest straight line ability. Roll, evade, roll, sheath, switch to fire staff, go to the burnout, then you're going to roll, switch to rapier, and go straight into a fletch, and then roll, evade, roll again. And when your internet isn't totally dying like mine is, It is the fastest rotation that you have in a straight line. All right, so that's pretty much it. I mean, take your time, practice this. It's going to take a lot of practice to master it, but eventually you're going to get it down. And as long as your animation canceling all of those rolls successfully, and you're mixing in most of your abilities pretty much off of cooldown, even if you're not hitting the rotation perfect, you're generally going to be faster than pretty much every other build in the game. So you're going to have no trouble chasing people down or escaping almost anybody. Like sometimes when I'm running away from big groups of people, I'll even like stop to farm. Like if I see like an iron vein, I'll like stop and mine the iron vein. I'm so not afraid that they're going to catch up to me. And even if they do, I'm so confident that I can get away that I'm big chilling while running away, basically. So speed, very important. Definitely practice that. When they're ready to dodge, they're going to see you put your fire staff up, go for the cast. They're going to, oh, there's some people attacking you. They're going to see it coming. So save that for melee users who are, well, let's get a little fight going here, shall we? Save that for melee users who are rushing you down. Drop the pillar at your feet and then roll out of it. Oh, see, these guys are both using muskets. So we're not. Wow, these muskets hit like fucking trucks. Oh shit, I'm dead. Fuck. All right, please bear with me for a brief intermission. At the moment, I am going to have to be running all the way back to the fort that I was recording my YouTube video at. A couple guys showed up with muskets, little punk bitches playing like bitches, shooting with their muskets from a mile away. And if you don't mind, I'm just going to kill these two little punks before I get back to the video. And then as soon as I'm done with that, the video may resume. We'll wrap it up. I'm going to fast forward through most of the fight because they're playing like little bitches and they're running the entire time. So I hope you don't mind this brief little intermission. They're playing with muskets, so obviously you're going to want to find LOS to hide behind while you try to bait multiple people into a 1v1. I'm pretty much just going to let the footage roll to speak for itself. These guys are not that good. They're playing both double range and trying to run and hide and kite, and it's kind of hilarious. I'll let it roll. Just enjoy. One of those days. It's all about the he said, she said bullshit. I think you better quit. Get fucked. Hi, thank you for bearing with me for that brief intermission. Now, we can return to your regularly scheduled programming. Let's get back to the video. We're back and we're going to finish this video. So, final tips to say when you're dealing with ranged. Melee is kind of self-explanatory, but when fighting against range, I will say it is going to come down to who's hitting more shots and dodging more of the opponent's shots. So you want to really get... It depends on what weapon you're fighting against, how to mix up your dodge timing. A couple notes, muskets, the one range class you're going to want to get closer to. You're a little bit better at a medium to close range versus a musket to force them to switch over to their melee, and you want to outplay whatever melee weapon they have, preferably. You don't want to sit too far away because they don't have any travel time on their bullets, right? So, and then if you do need to disengage against muskets, you need to find LOS. Against most other weapons, you can just zigzag and create distance. Against the muskets, if you're out in the open, they're gonna just keep hitting you over and over again. You have to find a piece of LOS to actually cut off their view because they have that hit scan. Against fire and ice mages, you're gonna want to keep a little bit more range because that ice gauntlet gets a little bit better the closer that you are. So staying outside of the range where they're never gonna be able to hit you with an ice wall, and even out of range where it's tough for them to follow up on their ice storm, is going to be beneficial. And you want to be kind of at the peak of their range to hit you, because if they pepper you down and they get an advantage, you're going to want to be able to disengage, get bop some food, get your health back up, then re-engage. And then if they are in the disadvantage and they try to run, you're going to be able to chase them down, right? No problem. So and then in the other range, like bow and arrow is pretty much a hit even fight. It just comes down to who's hitting more shots and who's missing. Same idea there. If you're losing that fight, you're going to want to disengage, same as fire and ice. And what other ranges there? So that's musket, bow, fire and ice. That's pretty much most of it. Another tip against range, I'm never really using pillar of fire against an opponent who is fighting against me, who sees me, who's paying attention to me. You can definitely use it against someone who's fighting someone else and is not looking, but if they're looking and they see it coming, they're going to be able to dodge that just about every time. So, I mean, in some 1v1s, you can mix it in. It's kind of a Hail Mary, but I prefer to save that in case another melee comes up and starts to rush me. It's more guaranteed to just drop it at your feet and roll out and catch a melee with it. And then fireball, you want to save your fireball for whenever you get them to bottom their stamina out. So if you're peppering light attacks at them, it's going to force them to have to be more evasive, and they're going to have to spam their dodge rolls much quicker, and it's going to drain their stamina bar faster, at which point, once they have no stamina, the fireballs are pretty much a guaranteed hit because the AoE explosion is so massive, they can't really dodge it without a roll. And then the light attacks, the fireball, yeah. And then you can kind of charge in a heavy attack if you want when they have no stamina, because it's going to be harder for them to dodge. But yeah, you can mix up between light attack and heavy attack timings. If they start to be ready for your light attacks, if you're starting with light attacks and they start just rolling immediately, then you can fake a light attack and charge a heavy instead, and then flick it to wherever they roll to as a kind of conditioning punish. And vice versa, you know, if you're conditioning them with heavy attacks and they start to time it well, you can catch them off guard by quickly throwing a light attack at them and catch them before they can react. So that's pretty much it. And then against melee, just outplay them, try to stay out of melee range as often as you can. When you do get caught in melee range, bust out that rapier for a little bit of outplay and then switch back and forth. And this guy's getting attacked by these musket users again, so I gotta jump back into action. But yeah, that's gonna about wrap it up for this one. I hope you guys like it. If you did, feel free to drop a thumbs up. If you're looking for more content like this, I'm going to be putting out some more matchup guides in the future, finding the best players of each build in my server and teaching really how to outplay and maximize against each matchup. So if you're looking forward to that, drop a subscribe, hit the bell button, and I'll catch you guys in the next one. Fry out. Peace. I'm gonna mess this guy up.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing the chocolate starfish and the hot dog flavored water. Bring it on!
Everybody's judged by the fucked up face.
Got him.